Amen. Before I go into my message, and this is the end of the series, so last part of our series, I just want to say that Saturday, about 30 of you showed up and did a community project, and you guys did an amazing job. So we took a family who's a couple about 90 years old, and they could not take care of their yard anymore. So as you can imagine, everything has overgrown. We came in about 3.5 hours. We pulled out so much junk out of there. We trimmed and removed so many trees and stuff. You could probably see it on social media. And I just want to thank Ann Linares, who organizes our community director, Pastor Van, and all of you who came and helped. We're making a difference in our community. Why do we serve? Because we love. That's it. Why do we serve? Why do you serve on Sunday? Why do you serve in kids' church? Why do you serve your community? Because you love. Love cannot just be words. Love cannot be just a feeling. It's an action. Yes. Amen? And many of you get up early in the morning on Saturday and you break a sweat a little bit. You lost some weight, I'm sure. But you made a difference. And so I just want to encourage you, continue to love and continue to serve. God appreciates that. All right, let's give those 30 people who showed up a hand clap. Thank you for being there. I want us to open our Bibles to 1 John chapter 4, verse 16 through 18. And here's what it says. We know how much God loves us, and we have put our trust in His love. God is love, and all who live in love live in God. And God lives in them. What a beautiful promise. And as we live in God, our love grows more perfect. Say, more perfect. More perfect. Our love grows. It's not perfect yet, but it's growing more perfect. So we will not be afraid on a day of judgment, but we can face Him with confidence because we live like Jesus here in this world. Such love has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. If we are afraid, it is for fear of punishment. And this shows that we have not fully experienced His perfect love. I want to stop here. In the last many weeks, 7 weeks, this is week 8 of this series, we have been talking about perfect love and how it casts out fear. And how perfect love is good for your mental health. Right? We've talked about all that. And we said, what is perfect love? Because we've always heard, you must walk in perfect love. If you struggle with fear, I'm sure you've heard it in church all your life. You need perfect love. And when you ask, what is it? People just be like, I don't know. Just love people. I don't know. But we came up with a revelation. And we believe it came from the throne of God, that perfect love comes in four parts, just like a perfect pizza comes in four parts. Crust, sauce, cheese, and toppings, right? So if you want a good pizza, you need these four. And same thing, perfect love comes in four parts, and that is this. Part number one, the foundation. God loves me first, as much as He loves Jesus. You must get that revelation. How can you pray to a God who doesn't like you, or at least you don't think likes you? You got to get that. You got to settle it in your heart. You're not cursed, you're blessed. You're no longer an orphan. You're no longer some sinner to God. You are a son or a daughter. You got to settle that. Who is loved, even with your bad self. Even with, if you don't like your personality, or you hate your attitude, or you hate whatever, God loves you. Me as much as He loves Jesus. God loves you as much as He loves Jesus. That's the foundation. That's the crust. Number two, you must love yourself as God loves you. Bible says love your neighbor as yourself. Obviously you're going to love yourself, but you got to do it not in a selfish way, but in a righteous way. You must love yourself as God loves you. With all your imperfections, with all your weaknesses and mistakes, guess what? He loves you anyway. He's dealing with the weaknesses. He's going to finish what He started. Come on. But he's never going to stop loving you. What can separate us from the love of God? Nothing. Nothing. So you must believe, you must love yourself as he loves you in a righteous way. Number three, third part of this pizza, or perfect love, is that I must love my neighbor as myself. Because if I only receive the love of God, if I love myself, I can become selfish. I can become a narcissist. It's all about me. The love of God is not meant to come in and stay inside of me. It's meant to flow through me to others. God has called me to love my neighbor as myself. And if you don't, you become a stale believer. If you leave a cup of good water for 3 weeks on the sun, what happens to that water? You don't want to drink it. Same thing. If the love of God doesn't pour through us, we become selfish. And so a good thing became bad to me. Like St. Paul says, law is good, but when it entered a sinful man, it became bad to me. It produced certain desires in me. And number four part to this perfect pizza or this perfect love is that I must love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And notice in this verse that we read, it says our love is being perfected. You don't get all these four parts perfectly right away. You grow in perfect love. And as you grow in perfect love, it casts out fear out of your life. And how many of you know many mental sicknesses and come from fear? Many mental illnesses, and we all struggle mentally some areas, some more, some less. And psychologists tell us sometimes we struggle with mental illness for 10 years before we start acting out. It's true. We struggle for 10 years not dealing with stuff, and then we just like have a mental breakdown. Thank you. And that's not a good thing. You can't let the wounds of the soul go unhealed. Just like you take care of your wound when you have a wound on your hand or a foot or your tooth hurts, you got to take care of it. Same, when your soul hurts, you got to take care of it. And the best thing for your soul is love, because God is love. And if you walk in love, you're on the same wavelength. Amen. And so that's what we were talking about in this series. Today, I want to ask you, how do you apply it to your life? How to fight with perfect love. That's my topic today. And some of you are like, fight with perfect love? No, no, no. How to fight with perfect love against whatever is coming against you. How to use perfect love to fight whatever is coming against you. And today I want to make it practical. So let's talk about two case studies. So there's two single parents, whether they're man or woman, it doesn't matter. And they don't have a lot of money, and it's winter. And so they have to buy coats for their kids. Both of them are Christians. Both are broke, don't have a lot of money. They're single parent, one family income. They got a bunch of kids. They have to provide coats for the kids. This is based on a true story. One Christian heard this message about perfect love and says, I'm going to apply it. I'm going to use this message as a weapon. How many of you know God has given us a weapon to fight the enemy? The weapon of our warfare are not physical or not carnal, but mighty through God for pulling down strongholds. Amen. You have weapons. Every time you listen to a message like this, it upgrades your soul, your inner man. How many of you know that? Every time you listen to a message like this, if you let it, it will upgrade you. Okay, let me just speak more plainly. How many of you are into video games here? Okay, I have one kid on us, thank you. Okay, yes, our worship pastors too, yeah. Everybody, I mean, most people here, 2/3 probably into video games. It's fine, no problems. How many of you know when you go on your phone and you buy a new app or you get a free app, some cool new game, they give you a free trial or free app, first level at least is free. And then as you play that game, what happens? You get a pop-up. Pop-up says, how would you like to improve your game and buy armor? $2.99 only, or $1.99, or even 99 cents sometimes, right? I actually got this from my 9-year-old daughter, Hadessa. I brought her in yesterday. I was preparing for this message. I'm like, Hadessa, teach me, because she loves video games on her iPad. And I was like, teach me. So she was so excited that she was contributing to the message today. But she said, Dad, if you want to win more land, you know, if you want to build forts and castles, and if you want an army to protect those forts and castles, you have to buy. She says, I don't have any money, but I can gain points and I can buy with points. But when, if she did have money, she would use it. And she said, you can buy weapons, you can buy tanks, you can buy helicopters, you can build forts, you can get land, you can do all that. I said, what if you don't buy upgrades? She said, you'll die miserable. You'll just die, you'll be defeated. She said, if you buy armor, you can fight longer. Nobody can kill you right away. Okay? And I'm like, man, video games are like spiritual life. And every Sunday, every time you read the Word of God, every time you get a revelation, how many of you know you get upgraded? Every time the truth enters you and becomes flesh, becomes a part of you, you get an upgrade. Yes. How many of you know St. Paul says that the enemy daily will throw darts at you? But he said, but there's a thing called the shield of faith that you could raise up and deflect the attack of the enemy. Usually they come through your thoughts. Devil attacks us in our thoughts and we can deflect it. But what if you have no shield of faith? It's hitting you deep in your heart. And guess what? When the heart is broken, it's a doorway for enemy to come in. That's why Jesus said, I have come to heal the broken heart. That's why Psalmist, I believe, says he heals the broken heart and binds their wounds. God doesn't want you to walk with wounds on the inside, because that's where enemy comes in. He comes in an area of your need and your pain and your wounds and your broken heart. And some of us Christians we have been taught this: if you have a problem, pray and it will go away. But I've learned, this is many years of serving God, that you pray for God to give you power to fight the enemy and then he will flee from you. Prayer is not a cheap, easy, lazy excuse. You just pray and God is going to take care of it. I've struggled with fear for decade plus, where I felt like a spirit was following me no matter where I went. And he would be almost visible in the areas when I was by myself or alone. And I prayed for years and it didn't go away, until I'll tell you that story, how God taught me to overcome fear with his power in my life. But I had to fight. St. Paul writes to Timothy and says, fight the good fight of faith. So you just pray about it and it'll go away. No. You pray for strength to fight, to resist the devil, and he will flee. What if Jesus, when he was tempted by the enemy, just prayed, oh God, please, Satan is showing me all these kingdoms of the world. Please help me, or I'm going to give in and bow down. And no, Jesus didn't do that. He pulled out a sword of the Spirit and he said, it is written, Satan, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him alone you shall serve. And that was a strike with the sword of the Spirit. Many of you have been going to church, you're full of weapons, but you never use them. That's the problem with Christians. We're full of weapons, but we just pray about it. We never fight back the enemy. And that's why he has victory over our life. I need to use somebody for example. Somebody big. I was thinking of Russ. Russ is kind of, you know, he has more muscle than Eli, I think. Let's say, Russ, you were standing there and some punk little kid came to you and like, and starts punking you out. Says, I'm going to kick your, you know. And you're just standing there and you're like, and so the kid comes and just swings at you with his foot right between your, and you go on the ground and then he starts beating you and you just stand there doing nothing. For many of us, that's what the enemy does. He just keeps slapping you. He just keeps hammering you. And you are strong and powerful in the Lord. You have been given all these weapons. Especially in the last 8 weeks, you've got these four weapons. You have been upgraded, but you're just standing there looking at your enemy praying, God, please. God says, pull out that big whatever. Yeah, and just fight back. The enemy is not that powerful. He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Spirit of fear is not that powerful. It's a low energy spirit. But because you won't fight back, he's punking you. He's scaring you. You can't even pray by yourself because you think somebody is going to come out of the spiritual world and attack you. You don't fight back. And the Bible says fight the good fight of faith. Jesus showed us an example. When the enemy came attacking his mind, he fought back. And so let's talk about again about these two single parents. One heard the message, fight back. And he says, or she says, okay, I don't have the money to buy the coats. And I don't want my kids to get sick, you know, because they can't buy any coats. So I'm going to go to God. And I've heard and I believe that God is my Father, that He loves me as much as He loves Jesus. And I don't believe what Satan says about it. Satan says I'm cursed. Satan says I've made some bad mistakes and there's no recovery from this. But God says I'm loved and He can redeem my youth. He can renew my strength, right? And so maybe I don't have the money, but I know who my God is and I trust Him. He said He will never leave me or forsake me. Notice, when you say these words, contrary to what the enemy keeps whispering into your mind, you're fighting back. And so you say to God, God, everything that you have is mine. You said that, son, all that. Okay, so I need coats. This is nothing for you. So I trust you and I'm not going to live in fear and I'm not going to live in worry. I trust you to take care of this. The second single parent allows fear to overcome, allows the thoughts, that the same thoughts that the first one had. You're cursed. Yeah, I am. You're good for nothing. You're a loser. Yeah, I am. You made some bad choices. You can't change. God cannot fix that. Oh, yeah. Nobody loves you. Yeah. You know, you just keep, and you don't fight back. You know that it's not true that God doesn't love you. When Satan whispered, God doesn't love you, you're cursed. You know you're not cursed. You know you're blessed. You got a revelation of that. But notice, you don't fight back. You don't say, Satan, shut up. I'm blessed. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Or you can just pray about it. You pray for God to help you resist. You pray for God to give you strength to fight back. You're not passive. You're active. You're working with God. You're not just sitting there as a little, you know, baby kitten or something. And just like, you fight, God, you fight. I don't want to fight. No, you know who you are? You're made in the image of God. And you're a son. You're a daughter. And so the second person just allows the devil to bombard them with thoughts of lies. And then they believe not what God says, that they're loved as much as Jesus is. They believe what Satan says, that they're cursed. There's no redemption. That's it. It's over. And fear starts coming in. And how many of you know when fear comes in, we don't make good rational decisions. We fight or flight. Usually we flee. And many Christians are so afraid to fight. Every time new problems comes our way, we freak out, people. Every time the new something, we're afraid of something on TV. Oh my goodness, it's the end of the world. Instead, the Bible says, raise up your head. Do you know who you are? But we're just so afraid of fighting in the spirit. Why? And we just pray. God, do it. No, pray, God, give me strength. Samson, remember when he was between those two columns? I just read it actually, that's why I'm saying it in my Bible study, morning Bible study. But it says, Samson prayed, God, give me the strength to avenge my eyes. That's what he said. Right or not, it's Old Testament, whatever. But he says, give me the strength. He didn't say, God, knock out these roofs, these columns. No, he said, God, give me the strength. Ask God. Young people, ask God to give you the strength to do whatever you need to do. And so the first single parent pushed fear aside, reconfirmed the belief that who they are. They put the armor back on. They took the weapons in their hands and started shooting at the enemy. The second just had all the weapons, the same weapons, just surrendered. The first single parent went online, had an idea suddenly. Because when you walk in faith, God always gives you a good idea. When you walk in fear, it's like, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do. But when you walk in faith, God gives you an idea. And so this single parent, single mom goes online and says, hey, money is tight right now, but I really need to buy some coats for my children. Anybody have any ideas where? Well, there was a rich guy in the friend group who said, we have some coats we bought and our children didn't like them. So they've just been taking space. Come and take them. I'll deliver it, whatever. Somebody else says, there's 75% off in this store. Go over here and buy some inexpensive. Got so much pouring out from the community that before this person, single mom, knew, she had all the coats and she was praising God. This is based on a true story. The second single parent, single mom, Satan whispered, you just need a man. He will buy coats for your children. And because she was so much in fear, she's like, yeah, yeah, I need a man. I need a man. He will take care of me. This man was selfish. He didn't love her children. He didn't want to help. He just wanted her. He didn't want nothing. You know, and he just wanted her body. He didn't want her. He didn't want to get to know her. He just wanted her body. And so she fell into this relationship. She was feeling guilty. Not that we said anything from church, but she was feeling guilty and stopped coming to church for 3 years. Eventually, after many heartbreaks through this relationship, much abuse, finally she was able to leave and came back. But 3 years wasted for some coats. How much time do you waste when you make decisions out of fear? God will redeem it. God will forgive it 100% of the time, but you can waste a lot of time and create more baggage, more weights for yourself to carry every day. What are you going to do? Are you going to use these four weapons and fight back and win? Or are you going to believe what the enemy says? Whose voice will you believe? What about if you're struggling with depression? Let's case number two, struggling with depression. What do you do? Well, what is depression? What is the cause of depression? Well, depression is, I had a vision for my life and it's not happening. I'm getting old and it's not happening. I wanted to be married. I wanted to have children. I want to have a business, but it's not happening. That's one. And number two, part of depression is, I don't think I can do anything about it. I'm powerless. I have no control over this. And so, let's say two people, same people, struggling with the same thing. One is depressed and so is the other. One heard this message and he says, God, give me the strength to fight this. Yes, maybe my vision for my life is not happening, But you didn't put me on this earth, so I would just take the resources. Waste air, waste food, waste water. You didn't put me on this earth so I can waste. You have a plan for me. And maybe my plan is not happening, but your plan surely will. No one can stop you. So you start saying, God has a plan. Yes, maybe I'm not in control of my life. I cannot force somebody to propose to me. I cannot have money just drop on my lap. But I'm going to trust you because you love me as much as you love Jesus. And I'm not going to go for some cheap fix. I'm going to trust you, God. And you encourage yourself. David had to encourage himself in the Lord. You fight back the depression. You have to. Sometimes, yes, you do need pills. And you know, just to, because you're so low, you just have no energy to fight. But every time you feel a little bit depressed, remind yourself, God, you have a plan. And if nothing is happening right now, guess what? I'm going to enjoy this season. Because a couple of months ago, something was happening and I was so overwhelmed. I was praying for a little bit of time off. And now I have some time off and I'm depressed because I don't know what to do with myself. Isn't it what happens? The second person just says, I'm going to be low. I just don't have energy. And they just sink deeper and deeper and deeper. If you don't fight back your thoughts with the Word of God, if you don't arrest your thoughts, you have the authority to arrest them. Just like police officer has authority to arrest bad people, you have authority to arrest bad thoughts in your mind. They will continue and it will become stronger and they will possess you and they will overtake your life. And just like I said, people often don't know that they're struggling with mental illness for 10 years before they start acting out. This is what I learned in psychology. What are you going to do? Are you going to use the weapons that you've been upgraded with? Every Sunday you get upgraded. Every time you get a revelation, you get upgraded. I was listening to a pastor preach. I was in a bobcat moving dirt. I remember this moment. I was in a bobcat moving dirt. I was listening to a message and I heard a scripture that God, angel says to Daniel. He said, Daniel, greatly beloved. And when I heard that, I felt like God said to me, Alex, not just regularly loved, but greatly beloved. And I'm like, that's it. No more. I'm not just loved. I'm greatly beloved. How do you think God loves you? It's all on you. John says he was the favorite apostle, not because Jesus said it, because John believed it. And I said, I'm not just regularly loved by God. I'm greatly loved. And you can, if you take that revelation, it could be yours. And so the enemy says, God doesn't like you. I say, you stupid fool. What do you mean? I'm greatly beloved. I got a revelation and you can't change my mind. Some of you go into, God loves me, God doesn't love me. Settle it forever in your mind that you are, if you are in Christ, He can't love you anymore. He loves you with perfect love. Does God love Jesus with great love or just regular love? Great love. And if He loves me as much as He loves Jesus, then I'm greatly beloved. My prayers are different because I'm greatly loved. I'm favorite. My faith is different because I'm same for you. Oh, yeah, yeah. Some of you believe it. Some of you are like, okay, okay. I'm going to keep saying it till you get it. And how do you know? How do I know you get it? Because once in a while, somebody will come up to me and says, God loves me, and tears in their eyes. I'm like, I've been preaching this for years. What do you mean? You just got it? Yeah. I'm like, thank you, Lord. Another one bites the dust. You know, another one comes in. And so you can just fall deeper into that, whatever you're struggling with, or you can rise up and do a little bit of battle. I want to talk to the men here, to the guys. Ooh. All right. Most guys struggle with lust issues and pornography. When you guys look at a woman, not me, but you, and she's a little bit, you know, exposed a little bit here, you know, and maybe a little bit, just not enough clothes, let's just say that. Often your eyes just go like, and you can't help it, just go that way, right? And then obviously a lot of guys struggle with pornography because it's so easily available, okay? It's Netflix and chill, or it's porn and self-chill. I don't know. It's truth, though. And what you don't realize, man, is that a woman's body has become a god for you. The Bible says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. But for many men, we love the body of a woman with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. Quiet, that's okay, I know. And what you don't realize is a woman's body, not even the woman, because you don't know the woman, has become a god for you. Her body parts have become a god for you. I've struggled with lust. I know how guys think. And eventually I got tired. I said, God, I don't want to think like this. I don't want to feel like this. And God says, then put me in the throne of your heart. Take a body of a woman, her breasts, her booty, her whatever, out of your throne. Because want it or not, agree or not, for many of you, God is not on the throne. It's a body of a woman. Or a man, if you're, you know, there, it goes both ways, but mostly guys struggle with this. And guys, when you're tired of struggling with lust and pornography, all you have to do is you have to make a declaration. I will not, from this day on, make a woman's body my God anymore. That's it. Women are beautiful. They were created by God that way. Awesome. But she will not. The body, not even the woman, the body will not be on the throne of my heart. Something that I think of all the time. Something that I give my energy and attention to. I'm going to put God. I will love God with all my heart, soul, mind, and strength. And that's it. If you do that, 50% of power of lust will be broken out of your life. If every time you focus on a body part, you say, nope, God is above that. You can't even do it. You can say, body is here, God is over here. I put God on the throne. I'm going to think of Him. I'm going to look at His beauty and His holiness. And I'm not going to worship anything in my life other than God. Man, are you tired? Don't answer. To worship a woman's body parts. Because that is what we do when we're obsessed and that's all we think of. Some of you are like, man, he's way too much today. I know, because many of you fight with that. And many of you gave up. And I've had people tell me, I've been on computer watching porn for like 16 hours a day in a row to where I hated it, but I couldn't stop anymore. That's worship. You never worship God for 16 hours in a day. That's worshiping a body. And you can pray. Many of you guys pray, God, get rid of this lust thing. God says, no, I gave you that part of you for your wife, for your spouse. But I want to give you victory over you putting woman's body on the altar of your heart, on the throne of your heart. You can fight back, or you can just pray, God, remove it. And fighting back works. Fighting back works. I want to tell you a story, and I have to do it in 3 minutes, so here it goes. When I was 16 years old, I worked in a restaurant, and at the end of the day, I was the one left for a couple of hours. I had to clean up the restaurant, organize it, getting ready for, the next day, and I was the only one left there. So I would turn up music really loud, and I'll be just mopping and doing whatever I needed to do. I was 16 years old, and my supervisor returned. She forgot something. And as I was mopping, she was behind me. She screamed so loud. She said, "Turn off that music!" And when she screamed that, it's like my body went numb out of fear. I just freaked out. It's like I had tingles. And I tried to save it somehow, but for the next 10 to 15 years, close to 15 years, I had the spirit of fear walking behind me. I could feel him. And when I was alone, especially in church, and I was a pastor already, I would be in church alone. Everybody would leave. I still have to lock up the church, just like I had to lock up the restaurant at the end of the day. You know, pastors often leave last. And I couldn't stay. I would ask people, hey, can you hold on, wait for me so I can lock everything up, turn off the lights and heat and stuff, and then we can go together. Not because I wanted a relationship, but because I was afraid being in church alone. After about 14 or so, 15 years, I got so tired of that spirit. Because remember, these things don't get easier, they become stronger. Even praying, I could feel a spirit standing there trying to spook me. And one day I got so tired of it because I prayed, guys. I prayed for all that time. God, remove this spirit of fear. God has not given us a spirit of fear. We walk in perfect love and all this stuff, you know. We know the Bible verses. We grew up Christian. And one day I said, God, and I've heard a message that said, you have to confront the enemy. You have to confront the spirit of fear. And so I decided I'm going to do something crazy. At 11 p.m., I came to church at night by myself. Went to the basement. It wasn't remodeled yet like it is now. It's nice there now. But before, it was like a storage and stuff, you know, and just a little area. And I went to the basement and I said, God, I will not leave here. I will not leave here until that spirit of fear is broken over my life. I'm not leaving. And as I started praying, I felt like the enemy came in waves of fear attacking me. I felt like it wasn't one spirit, but like four or five spirits all around me, just like you know, cavalry on horses, just running around you and just like throwing darts at you. And what I would do is, I grew up assemblies, Pentecostal, you know, and so I would just begin to yell. I would say, in the name of Jesus, get out! But it would be panic and fear yell. But I said, I'm not leaving. And it would come in waves. And it was like they would come in through the door and they would circle me. Honest truth. My hair would stand up. My hair, you know, just goosebumps everywhere. I was experiencing such a spirit of fear. But I said, God, I'm not leaving. You give me victory. And about 2:30 to 3 in the morning, I heard the voice of God. And he said to me, don't yell at this demonic activity, because you're yelling out of fear. He said, take authority, because when you have authority, you don't have to yell. He said, take authority and command these things to get out. And I was like, I've never heard that before. We usually yell at everything in our church, you know, especially demons. We yell at them. And I said, in the name of Jesus, you have no right here. He who is in me is greater than you. So we, you know, I got a ghost living in me, Holy Ghost. We command you to go. And just like that, it's like, this thing would leave. And I'm like, oh, free. But I'm like, hold on. I'm not that naive, Satan. I'm going to try it again. So I keep praying again. These things like drove in into the room and start circling me. And the fear came back. And I said, in the name of Jesus, leave. And they would leave. And I did it till 7 in the morning, until I found out, what am I doing? I'm just wasting time now. I got the victory already. And I left. And for the last, I don't know, 15 years, not 15, maybe 10 or so years, I have never struggled with spirit of fear. From 11 to 7, 7-11, but it was 11-7. You can pray about it, yeah. But you're praying wrong because you're praying for God to do it. And God says, no, 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 no. Pray that I would give you strength to fight the good fight and win the fight. And so you have been given 4 weapons in the last 8 weeks. It's yours. It's a revelation. Hopefully you got it. What are you going to do with it? Are you going to just surrender it and forget about it? Or are you going to fight with it and win battle after battle over enemy in your life? Would you stand to your feet? Were you blessed by this series message? I want to pray, Father, in Jesus' name, whatever your people are struggling with, whatever this next thing that they've been just battling for so long, God, I pray you give them victory in the name of Jesus. I pray you give them strength to find the verses in the Bible, to find the truth in your word and fight the good fight of faith so they can receive the promises that you have had for them. Holy Spirit, you live in them. You are there to help. You are called a helper, God. Not a doer for people. You're not going to do it for us, but you're going to help us do what we need to do for the kingdom of God and for the glory of God. And so I pray for your people. Give them strength to act upon what they've heard so their lives would never be the same. In Jesus' name I pray. And the people of God said, amen. Come on, clap your hands and bless God.
If you need... Thanks for tuning in to New Life Sermon Series Online. If you're blessed by these messages and are interested in helping spread the Word of God to others, make an investment today. You can give at newlifechurchsf.org. If you have a story or a testimony to share, let us know on our website as well. We hope you have a blessed day and enjoy today's message by Pastor Alex.